Hey there, welcome to the Hot Slice Podcast. I'm your host, Jeremy White, editor-in-chief of Pizza Today magazine. And I'm joined by Denise Greer, who is the executive editor of Pizza Today. Good morning, Denise.
Good morning, Jeremy. Hey, we got somebody pretty exciting on the lineup today.
Yeah, we've got a big name, one of the biggest names in the pizza industry, Mr. Tony Gemignani, who owns and operates several different concepts on the West Coast. Tony is an all-around great guy, contributor to Pizza Today, Pizza Expo, the PP&E show in Atlantic City. He really does a lot for this industry.
Yeah, he's definitely a leader. And I can say, I know you've been to some of his spots in San Francisco. I've been to Pizza Rock in Sacramento and Las Vegas. And I got to tell you, the New Yorker pizza is still one of my favorite all-time pizzas that I've ever had.
It's good stuff. And, you know, his one of his concepts in San Francisco, Tony's, is probably my personal favorite pizzeria in the United States.
You're not allowed to tell anyone.
I know,
that.
I'm not supposed to say that, but you and I have traveled extensively. We've been a lot in lots of pizzerias. You know, we've been in the Hallmark pizzerias in Brooklyn. We've been everywhere. And I would be very hard pressed to put together a top 10 list. I would certainly leave out some great ones, but I think Tony's, because of the variety that he has available, he has many different styles available, many different ovens. It's a pretty unique place. You know, you can get a Neapolitan, you can get a New York style. There's so many different types of pizza you can get in that one spot that kind of makes it a little pizza nirvana for me personally.
Yeah. And one of the great things about Tony is he's so approachable. I mean, I think a lot of people are kind of intimidated because they see his name out there and they're just like, oh, I don't know, I can't go up to Tony. But Tony is so approachable. He's so willing to answer questions and talk about what he's doing and what successes he's found and also where he's had some misses. I mean, he's pretty open. He's a pretty open book about his concepts.
You know, he really is. He's been around for 30 years. He's not a very old guy. He got started when he was very young and green behind the ears. And as you said, through experience, through trial and error, through hits and misses, he's acquired a lot of knowledge. He's traveled the world extensively. He goes to Italy and he really, you know, gets to the heart of the matter, whether he's looking in a Parmesan cheese or, you know, a ravioli dish, whatever he's there for, he really researches diligently and then experiments until he perfects it. And he is very willing to share that knowledge of that information. I know that he spends a substantial amount of his time each and every day talking to pizzeria owners on the phone, returning their text messages, returning their emails. And he's almost like a primary care physician. He gets, you know, you don't know what you're going to see. One person is asking him about dough. Another person is asking him about marketing. Another person is asking him financial questions. And he's got to try to filter all of this and figure out how to help them out. And he's always willing to do that. I never hear someone call me up and say, man, Tony was a jerk. He turned me away. He wouldn't help me out. I always get calls and emails. Oh my gosh, thank you for telling me about Tony. He's a godsend. He helped me out so much. And what's so cool is just what you said earlier, that he is always willing to share that with his peers. He really wants to see not just himself and his businesses succeed, but he wants to see the entire industry elevate. And that's really cool because not everyone has that mentality. And that's one thing that makes Tony a very, very special individual.
Yeah, he definitely looks to, you know, have the industry rise. Well, let's just jump right into our conversation with Tony. So here's Tony Gemignani.
Hey, everyone. It's Katie, art director at Pizza Today, here to interrupt your podcast with a short commercial break. For over 32 years, the multi-award-winning PDQ POS system has consistently been a top-rated point-of-sale system for pizzerias, delivery, and quick service. With built-in and seamless integrations to all top-tier third-party platforms, native online ordering and rewards, contactless POS functionality, and a delivery toolkit app that enhances all aspects of delivery, PDQ POS will help your restaurant achieve sustained growth while saving time, effort, and costs. Learn more today at pdqpos.com or call 877-968-9968. 877-968-6430. That's 877-968-6430. And now, back to the slice.
Tony, you just spent last week reopening Capo's, your business in San Francisco. Why was it closed, and how did the reopening process go?
Yeah, no, that was an interesting process. You know, at one time when we had to close the stores, or at least just be open for to-go and delivery, Capo's was actually about a block and a half away from Tony. So I integrated Capo's into Tony's and with Slice House all connected. So we really did, you know, almost three concepts out of one to make ends meet. So I didn't have to have a team over there, and which we weren't really doing really big volume. So it just made sense from an efficiency like point of view, or just a labor point of view or perspective. And when I did that and I started to go and delivery our style pizzas that we sold out of San Francisco, out of Tony's, took off, and it was it really kind of catapulted it. And I'm not sure why, because we have pan pizzas, you know, we offer grandmas, we offer Sicilians. So all of a sudden, I kind of saw Rose in Detroit. And during that 3 month time period, I was looking at the Capo's model, which Capo's is a Chicago concept. It has four predominant styles: deep dish, cast iron skillet. It has cracker thin, and it has stuffed. And then we have Italian dinners like chicken Vesuvio or steaks that we actually offered at one time, and baked pasta dishes. And when I was looking at that, or thinking about that concept over those 3 months of just being in Tony's and doing what we're doing, I said to myself, I think I need to revamp Capo's a little bit. I need to look at it like I'm looking at the eaters that are eating now. I paid attention to the clientele. It was a much younger audience. Even when cocktails started to happen at Tony's, and you're able to sell those to people outside, and I'm looking at the people picking it up, and it wasn't that 65, 70 year old, even 55 year old clientele. It was more of a 21, 25, 30, 35, 40 clientele. And they seem to be, obviously, as you see in the news, a little, they seem to be gumming out a little, you know, they're not taking it as serious as what it is. Everyone's kind of different when it comes to the coronavirus right now and the pandemic, you know. So when it came to that, I was looking at that eater. I was saying to myself, you know, if this does take off and we do reopen again, I don't think you're going to see the elderly as much. I don't think you're going to see the fine dining, obviously, as much. I don't think you're going to see that pizzeria, because, you know, Capo's is very upscale, reservations, big booths, whiskey bar. I mean, when you look at that concept, it was that formal kind of setting, that birthday, anniversary, Father's Day kind of place you'd go to. It was more of a place that you'd go to like maybe every 6 weeks to every like celebration, rather than getting those people in your seats every week and having your clientele be, you know, there. So I looked at it, I'm going to change the menu. And the first thing I thought of was, well, I should move Detroit over there. You know, we're getting so busy on Detroit. You know, Tony's has, you know, seven ovens, all these styles of pizza. And all of a sudden you see this uptick in Detroit, and it's bogging up the ovens. So somebody wants St. Louis or Roman. And even though I have all these ovens, it actually oversaturated. It actually like diluted everything else. And Detroit was, I mean, I want to sell pizzas, but at the same time, it's like, man, is this just a Detroit concept and everything changed? So I say, hey, let's move Detroit to a brick and mortar. Let's make Capo Chicago style pizza and Italian dinners. Let's just change it to Capo's Pizza and umbrella Detroit under it. Let's go with a new logo. Let's bring in a new chef. I wrote it up a small plates, something that's more affordable, more attractive, definitely kind of a younger kind of crowd that likes to get, you know, fried squash blossoms and lardo and speck with house-made focaccia, things on there that could be fast, quick, more efficient in the kitchen. So I really was kind of redrawing, rethinking and redrafting Capos during this pandemic, and it launched last week.
Wow, that's a major overhaul. That's not just we're going to make a few subtle changes here and reopen. I mean,
yeah, you even saw the video. I don't know if you saw me. People were laughing. I jackhammered a wood-fired oven out of the restaurant. We had a small wood-fired oven, and we did clams, casinos. We did some really cool dishes. Stuff as a chef, you're just like cringing because, as a chef, you want to do these great dishes and you're like, you hate to see them go. So I'm looking at that oven saying, I need more refrigeration. I need more room. We do baked mostaccioli out of here. There's only a few items I do out of here. Let me just, take this oven out. So everyone's like, what the heck's up with Tony? He's like, there's this video of me like jackhammering this oven and you can't get it out. Once you move a wood fired oven or a wood stone oven or anything that's kind of a big oven, it ain't gonna fit through a door, and you have to take down a wall to do it. It's more money to take down the wall or break through the front of the restaurant to get this thing out. So there's been times that I've destroyed an oven and people are like, oh, cringy, and I would have took that oven, or Sarah Murray's all, what are you doing? What is he, nuts? Like, we even destroyed an oven, and there's some funny video on that people are laughing about, but you got to do what you got to do. You have to adapt. You have to make changes. And it was definitely a model that it's one of the models I've always loved dearly. It never was a model that made a lot of money. I've always been honest with everyone with that. I put a lot of money into those payrolls over the years. It was something I designed, I built, I fell in love with. It's that hard-headed guy that I'm not going to give up. Very much of a stubborn chef, stubborn owner that says, hey, keep it going. And now I did an overhaul and let's see, let's hope it works.
So, well, I'm sure it will. I mean, everything you touch seems to turn to gold. Denise, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Oh, no worries. Oh, I was curious, how have your Capo tried and true, those big fans, how have they responded to the concept change?
Well, they love Detroit. They've come in. So it's funny. So there's a few things I swallowed, and these listeners are going to be like, what? I added a couple pizzas that they stuff that I was doing 30 years ago when I was with Paisanos. We did everything. We did ham and pineapple ranch. We did everything. When I came into the San Francisco market, there's certain things I couldn't do. Wings, ranch, barbecue pizzas, cheeseburger pizzas, ham and pineapple, because in San Francisco, writers are just ready to eat you up. Writers are just bloggers. I mean, it's San Francisco. But if you look at Pizza Rock, we have that. So did I throw a ham and pineapple on there? I did. And I did that. I've done that before. I'm not a guy who's afraid or not afraid to say, hey, yeah, I like ham and pineapple. I do. And I like pepperoni and pineapple. And I like a lot.
I'm glad you
like
said that.
So I'm not. I am a man that can admit it. So so when it comes to that, yeah, we added some new pizzas. Yeah, we took off a lot of staple, tried and true items off the menu. So I would say it's funny. Almost everybody has loved it. The number one pizza there right now, even if you were to ask Laura, because she's the chef, Chef Laura Meyer is actually the chef there, is the ham and pineapple pizza. The ham and pineapple Detroit, the ham and pineapple cracker thin. But, our ham and pineapple isn't just ham and pineapple. It's prosciutto, honey bacon, ham. It's sliced pineapple rings that we've been doing fresh, and we soak them in pineapple syrup that makes it sweet or even sweeter. So when you look at our ham and pineapple, it's not just the tidbits and a, Canadian style bacon that you throw on it. We kind of definitely kicked it up a notch to make it really kind of that San Francisco premier ham and pineapple kind of pizza. But going back to your question, did we get a customer like on the second day that came and it was their anniversary and they come to Capo's like every year and they sat down and they're like, you don't have lasagna? What? Like, so I had to go out to the table and kind of say, they're all, this is our 20 year anniversary. And they're kind of telling me, and I brought my wife, and I'm like, I'm sorry, during the pandemic, I had a change. And luckily during that time, I'm like, wait a minute, is your 20 year anniversary? And then they said, yeah. I'm like, it's my 20 year anniversary. And they said, I'm all, but not today. It was yesterday. They're all, ours is yesterday. So I kind of got that one out of there. We had something, they're excited. They got married the same day I did. And all of a sudden everything was cool. And I got them you know, mostaccioli, and they forgot about that. And I dropped some dessert. So we had a little bit of a pushback, but I would say 90% of it's probably been really, really positive. And just bringing Detroit, I mean, it's a pan pizza. Does it go well with Chicago? Is it a belly buster? Do they like substance? You know, when it comes to that particular style, does it marry well with, you know, Chicago and Detroit? You know, and if you look at Capo's as well, it's kind of mobish, and it goes with the outfit of Chicago. When you think of the outfit, very much mafia influence. And then you go into the partnership, which was out of Detroit. And you look at some of the things that have gone on with Jimmy Hoffa and a lot of the Teamsters. So I brought that element included, you know, with the Chicago element as well. So when you walk in, you see like old like 50s and 60s hubcaps, Cadillacs, and you see stuff with Jimmy Hoffa that kind of goes with the Chicago theme of San Giancana and Capone and stuff. So it really, really married well together, and I infused them both, and it was almost a perfect fit, honestly.
That's cool. You know, Tony, you've overseen or operated or owned several different concepts. You're always on the go. You're always on the move. You're always experimenting and trying new things. What goes through your mind? What's kind of your planning process, or your, you know, intellectually, how does your mind work when you're planning out a new concept, and you have to take the holistic approach. You have to think about the menu, you know, what kind of menu you're going to present, but you also have to think about the name and the ambiance and what kind of decor, like you just talked about. You have to take all of that into consideration. Can you just kind of tell us a little bit about your process, what it's like when you're sitting down and planning a new, you know, a brand new concept, or in this case with Capo's, you essentially did create a new concept in a way.
Yeah. You know, I think I like to do everything. I'm when it comes to that, I'm a bit of a jack of all trades. I am the designer. I enjoy it. When I look at it first, I get into this chef's mind. I say, okay, I want to do anything and everything. House-made sausage, pool mozzarella, let's do it. And then you're the guy that pulls back. I'm the chef, the young chef in me says, let's do everything. And then the smart guy that's been around for 30 years kind of goes back and says, well, let's execute, and let's make sure we can execute the menu and we don't overdo it. And I can add something 3 months later. So when it comes to the menu, a lot of what are people asking for? What do people want? I listen. And this one, I really listen. I swallowed that pineapple pride. And I said, you know, let me do that. Let me do a ranch pizza. Let me do what people are want. You know, it's a service industry. And if somebody wants to get my margarita and put spinach on it, and even though I tell them, you know, hey, that's not really going to work out, will I adapt and will I do it for the customer? I typically would. And when it comes to, a lot of people say, of course you would. But when you're in up to a level in certain parts of the country, like a New York and LA, a San Francisco, and you're at a, not just so much a pizza parlor, but you're not even, you know, we're still a pizzeria, but we're definitely more chef driven. If you look at a lot of the pizzas we do, but am I able to adapt and do that? I'm not giving $2 off, $1 off and everything like that. We're not going into the couponing game like restaurants do, but we are willing to do what customers want. And if you ever are in the chef world, I've been around guys that I've hired, and they're like, you know, F that, we're away. You're going to do that. You're going to screw up your pizza. Go tell that customer, man. I'm like, listen, the server just made $3 on top of that pizza. I'm okay. I've done this before. It's just, if the customer wants it, if they really muck it up, then I'll go to the table and say, look, the Calitalia has fig and prosciutto and balsamic reduction. Put an anchovies on that, really wouldn't really play well. So I just want to let you know that. It's a pizza I want on the Food Network. That pizza's special to me. Okay, that's different. But if a guy got a pepperoni and it's a standard combo, we would add to it. So when I look at that, and I'm a bit of a timeless operator, I like to walk into a concept, and especially if you see Tony's, Giovanni's, Slice House, and you also look at Capo's. I like timeless. I like that feel. Timeless to me is a very classic design. sometimes I look at efficiency. You know, at one time I used to have horseshoe booths, and when it comes to horseshoe booths, those aren't practical when it comes to seating and sitting down customers. So a banquette that runs along the wall, when you have a four top, two top, can be pushed together to make a 10 top or a 12 top rather than having horseshoe booths. So there's this side of me that's very artistic that looks at things and say, this is what it is. And then there's times that I've pulled out something that I built that was 10 grand. And I said, you know what, we need to redesign this. It's wrong. It's not practical. Capos was the thing. I did that. Actually, it took me a lot of years to do that. We had these three giant horseshoe booths that fit six, six, and six. You couldn't put them together. And then I made it a big banquette down the line and made it a 2-4, 2-4, 2-4, 2-4, and which could have been almost a 20 top. So being versatile in a restaurant's important. Being comfortable in a restaurant's important. Communal is important to a younger crowd, but it's not important anymore. So all those concepts that were communal and had those long bench style seats or high top style tables that aren't really working right now because communal has kind of changed a lot because of the pandemic. People aren't sitting next to each other as much as they were able to. So for me, I think of the name, I think of the concept and the style. I think of the look of the restaurant, the entry. I like my bar to be a focal point. I like people sitting at my bar. People eat at my bars. That's one thing that's important. They're not just drinking. So when it comes to that bartender, that he or she needs to know that they need to know the menu. They need to know it back in and back and forward. Sometimes you'll get bartenders that just want to serve cocktails, but not at my restaurants. You know, and you also look at it as, you know, the beer profile, the cocktail menu, the wine program, if it matters. I mean, you think of the wine program at like Tony's, it's very extensive. You know, we won Wine Spectator for years. And all of a sudden you walk into Capo's, into Pizza Rock in like Las Vegas or Sacramento, and it's shots and beers and maybe some cocktails and a very, very limited wine list. So if you look at the concept of what it is and how it is when you walk in, you know, is this shots and beers? Am I going to have 100 beers, which include taps and bottles and cans? Or is it just going to be like, you know, 8 local beers, which I did at Capo's. I pulled most of my imported bottles and cans and taps out. I overhauled it. I saw that a lot of these local breweries were having trouble, like Triple Voodoo, but places that you haven't heard of, Pine Street, a lot of guys that were all local that were having trouble and people were pulling their beer left and right. I went to them and say, I'm going to make 80% of my taps all local. Let's try to help out 4 points and let's try and do that. And I even did an overhaul to actually the beer program at Capo. So I look at it from front to back and top to bottom. I think about everything. And we even think about like, what do the bathrooms look like? And it's just so important of what's the door going into the kitchen at Capo's look like? Should it feel like you're going into this back room, you know, the hideout kind of feel? It's just, there's so many elements involved into a restaurant. It's just not about making great pizza. It that will just not, you know, bring people in. It's the experience and it's really everything. And I try to look at everything. Even the design of the menu, where pizzas are placed on the menu are so important. And does the name of that concept match the vibe when you walk in? Does Pizza Rock, when you walk in, is it the vibe? And does Capo's, when you walk in, you're like, wow, this is old school. I wonder what's around this corner. And when you just come into Tony's, you're like, geez, this is awesome. This is like a classic, timeless kind of look. So, yeah.
Yeah, and I know I've been to Pizza Rock in Sacramento and Las Vegas, and it definitely fits the vibe with, in Sacramento, you have the big truck smashing through the wall and things with the TJ booth in it. I mean, it's definitely an expression. It's very...
Yeah, I mean,
very
cool. We always call it eatertainment, you know, eatertainment when it comes to that is like, it's just not all about like the best food you can make. I mean, even in my little 900 square foot slice house, is it exposed brick? And is it the tile that we want, that subway tile in the back? And is there a beautiful like pizza showcase when you walk in? And are there, or it can be from the 900 square foot concept to the 9,000 square foot concept. I mean, there are things you could do aesthetically to make a place look good. I know when we licensed Slice House Haight-Ashbury, it's a perfect example. A group wanted us to look at their pizzeria. I knew one of the family members or one of the partners in it. We walked in. It's on Haight-Ashbury, which if you don't know what Haight-Ashbury is, it's the 60s revolution of peace, love, not war. You know, from anywhere from Jimi Hendrix would be hanging on this street in San Francisco to Janis Joplin and Jefferson Airplane. So it's a place that I always went to as a kid. You go shop and hang out, you know, do stupid things as a kid. And it's based around a really nice, beautiful area of San Francisco where people have money and affluent place. So I went and looked at this place and you walked in, there was an ATM machine. It was a beat up counter. It was aesthetically all wrong. There was nothing feng shui literally about this. When you tried to walk in, it was broken down, beat up. And they said, we love your pizza. We'd love to do something with you. Would you want to make it a slice house? And I said, yeah, I mean, I'd love to make it a slice house. I mean, you're on Haight-Ashbury. I mean, like there's not almost a better street to be on. So when I walk in and I brought my partner, George, I said, look, if we had an artist come in and paint on the wall and we change the ceiling to make it look like a tin ceiling or aesthetically and change the floor and everything that the customer saw up until the counter. And then beyond that, the hoods are fine. Your Baker's Pride that you have back there are fine. You have an old Hobart mixer. Nobody sees your walk in. Your bathroom's good. We can clean up back here and get the right shelving and get this wood shelving that you'd buy at like, I mean, stuff that wasn't even, you know, allowed really. But over the years, it's 20 years, 25 years, this pizzeria was on the street and they were doing really bad volume. So aesthetics are so important in how you walk in. And we did do that and retransform that. If you ever go on their website or try and do some searches and you see, you know, Jimi Hendrix on the wall, the Beatles, there's pictures of Janis and Joplin and we changed the lighting. I mean, we did do that change. They tripled, I would say they tripled business slightly or even more from what they were doing per week.
Wow.
They are still around. They're building a second concept as we speak, another slice house that we're going to license. And, you know, when it comes to aesthetics and lighting and you know, your windows and are they able to open up? And I mean, they had the perfect rent. Honestly, I mean, a rent that you'd be like, oh my God, for this street really is like long-term, low cost. And they were on a main drag that was just crazy to see. And it was just a little bit of love, care, and ideas to really make this concept what it is. And of course, changing their pizza and overhauling it and making it great. That was also important too. But yeah.
Hey everyone, it's Katie, Art Director at Pizza Today, here to interrupt your podcast with a short commercial break. Performance Food Service is proud to deliver high-quality products, innovative technology, and custom operational solutions to restaurants of all sizes across the country. The flagship division of Performance Food Group, with deep roots in the restaurant industry, Performance Food Service has been the exclusive distributor of the Roma family of brands for more than 65 years. This signature relationship has allowed Performance Food Service to become a leader in the pizza and Italian segment of food service nationwide. And now, back to the slice.
You know, Tony, you mentioned rent. Obviously, in San Francisco, you're one of the highest priced cities in the nation in terms of rent, in real estate value, things like that. But for others who are listening to this podcast, who are, you know, maybe in the Midwest, the Southeast, do you have a rule of thumb from a business perspective when you're looking at a new location? What percentage of your projected income, for example, that you think rent should be at?
Yeah, you have a 10% threshold that you usually calculate into, you know, your project. So when you have that 10%, I would be rather closer to 5 than closer to 10 in anything. You know, it all depends on where you go. It's funny, Walnut Creek, we have a 900 square foot concept in Walnut Creek that is my highest rent, definitely my highest rent per square foot, but it's almost like one of my highest rents anyways, even not even based on per square foot, it's just based on like what I pay per month when it comes to that. The rent is extremely high, but we're doing big, big numbers. It's on a main drag across the street from Neiman Marcus, Tiffany's. It's in an area like, it's the Rodeo Drive, I guess you could say, of Walnut Creek, California. It's not Rodeo Drive, but it's definitely like what you would feel that that's what it would be like. So have I been willing to go into areas that had extremely high rent and take that chance of hopefully doing the volume that that I should be or could be doing? And I have done that before. But are we smart about rent, and have we tiered our rent to have a base rent that would coincide with sales? Whereas if you were to make a percentage of sales as a landlord, do we have a minimum and then kind of a maximum tier? And basically, if the more, the better I do, the better the landlord does. And if something drops like 9/11 or the coronavirus of what's going on now, and we went from a $7 million store that was doing big numbers and it dropped to a 2.8 and 3, and would that percentage rent be eliminated because we went under a threshold? Yeah, I have that in about 4 different concepts right now, that if, you know, if something major happened like it did, so that has saved us in certain areas. So I've capped it at a certain point. There's a threshold. If it goes under a certain amount, it eliminates the percentage rent and it goes to X. Right now, the balls, I've had a lot of deals come to me in the last month. I might be looking at one thing right now, but I'm market's very unstable. It's a buyer's market right now. Sure. It's a tenant's market. Now, landlords know it. There are $10,000 a month leases that are gone to five. There's also in leases right now, I was told that what's great for us is that act of God, crisis, all these things are being put into, the language is putting into for the tenant, that if they have to shut down or if there's a pandemic and all these things, there's all these languages that are going in now to everything, that you're not paying rent if something happens and you're automatically shut down because the city, the government, the state, or just in general, the U.S. just makes you shut down. So right now there's some sweet deals going on. I mean, there are places that you can go into that are fully equipped, and it's sad because you don't want to see that, because nobody wants to see all these businesses be out. But there are some corner spots and some amazing locations that you're going to see a lot of newer chains or a lot of growth in that area because there's so many good deals. So it's definitely a buyer's market right now. And these landlords have to give good deals out there now. And I've talked to them. I've seen some leases be cut in half. I've seen liquor licenses go down 70%. So like in San Francisco, a liquor license, full liquor license in North Beach would be about 300,000. Back in the day, at least back in the day, sad thing is, back in the day was only like 7 months
ago. Right.
but really, it was about 300,000 for a full liquor license. Now I've been seeing full liquor licenses for 100,000, 125,000, and you know, you keep the restaurant fully equipped, you know, and people aren't even really biting at that right now. So liquor licenses are incredibly amazing right now. Equipment, you know, no money key, you know, it's just crazy what things are like right now. So yeah, if you're opening up a restaurant, which some guys are, which is a little crazy, but just because we never know what it might be, that there's definitely times to renegotiate that lease you maybe signed 3 months ago or 6 months ago, because it ain't what it was. And I'll tell you that right now.
No, it's not.
Brokers really know it. Yeah, they know
it. So with all that being said and all that in mind, are you considering your track record of success, are you looking to capitalize on that and grow, or are you still thinking, wow, you know, I don't know what's going to happen with this pandemic and there's no need to, tie my money up and
yeah, you know, it's funny. I've been going back and forth. My wife and I have been talking a little bit about that. So we have we actually licensed the concept. It's going to be coming to Boise, Idaho.
Oh, wow.
I haven't announced that yet. There's ghost kitchens that are popping up. And obviously during this pandemic, ghost kitchens have done extremely well. Slice house concepts, delivery to go, mm-hmm. Just type concepts have been doing extremely well. So there's been a group, several groups in the U.S. that have been working on ghost kitchens, bringing together chefs from different states, building 15, 16, 17 different hubs within one, where they are just delivering the heck out of food. And this could be anywhere from pizza to Chinese, to dumplings, to donuts. So when it came to that, we were looking at this deal and talking about doing this in a few different areas. So for me, licensing is much less risky than other types sure. of models, like, you know, so raising funds and moving forward. But we've been able to actually, they came back to us and said, well, we're doing fine, you know, and it's not everybody who's been able to do that and say, hey, we're doing fine during this. So we have licensed a concept. We are looking at franchising the Slice House model. We haven't franchised yet. I've licensed in ballparks, and I've been talking to everyone from the Warriors a lot to the Giants to the Niners on expanding within their arenas and stadiums. We are trying to figure out what that's going to look like. Is it going to be 50% occupied? I mean, every time you turn on anything with sports on it, things have been getting hit and going backwards a little bit. So unfortunately, that outlook we don't really know about. But we have expanded in a new stadium that I haven't been able to announce that's going to reopen eventually. And I can't say what it is, but it's definitely revolves around football. So we have expanded some. Are we looking at trying to find investors and saying, hey, this is a time to build. Let's build Slice House. Let's grow it. That model is a model that can make it through this. And obviously I do have some concepts that have done well, but the majority of actually haven't done well. I mean, some places are, now that there's dining available for outside, or in Las Vegas, it's available minimal for inside. I'm anywhere from 20% down, 50% down, 15% down. I would probably say two of my stores right now are still 50. One's 50 probably, and the other one is about 60 or 70. Everything else is about 15 or 5 or 10. But I do have a couple models that are actually doing better. And then one of them is that there's Slice House models, the smaller ones that are just doing crazy delivering to go. So I am looking at, well, which one is, you know, is would make it during the pandemic and what did. And I'm kind of focusing more towards the Slice House model on growth. So we are looking at trying to franchise that. And it's something that we think that was going to take a back seat in everything. I was looking at Big Box, Pizza Rocks, Nationwide. Right now, that's in a back seat right now. I it's a little scary. I think everybody that has those 180-seat restaurants, 9,000-square-foot, 7,000-square-foot footprint, are re-looking at their model. So that one's taking a back seat, and Slice House is definitely is trying to go full throttle right now.
Yeah, it seems that this pandemic of amongst many other things has just really forced us all to simplify, and that kind of what you're seeing with your concepts, noting that the Slice Houses and the more simple streamlined concepts are the ones that are performing well during all of this. It makes a lot of sense. So it sounds like going forward, at least in the short term, that's you know, that's where you're going to put your attention.
Yeah, you know, I'm lucky, I guess, that I'm lucky and unlucky to have different models to look at. I mean, I have little fast casuals. I have little boxes and arenas that aren't obviously even open right now, but they're licensed, so it's less risky for me. And then you have the big dining restaurants, which Tony's is kind of a combination of both, but Pizza Rocks are big. And where are they located? You know, we're looking strategically. Where are they located? What are conventions going to be like in the future? What are ballparks and arenas? What are hotels? You know, we're in an area in Sacramento that's really tough. We're around all of those, and we're also by the Capitol, and we're surrounded by a lot of hotels. So you're just looking to the right, behind you, to the left. There's an arena to the left. When you walk out, there's the convention to the right, and behind the restaurant is the Capitol. And right now, it's there's protests going on. There's very angry people out there. People that are upset. There's places that people may not want to go because it feels unsafe as a customer. And there's a lot of people aren't staying in the hotels or hanging out. So it's that one's a particular challenge. We're trying to get creative and market and do the best we can, but if there's just no people, it's just, you can't feed them. So, and that's a tough one, even with, you know, just bringing their pizzas out to them with curbside pickup. It's just, they're afraid to drive down the street because they don't want to run into some march, and they wouldn't get back home for 3 or 4 hours because they got stuck in it or their car got vandalized. So there's a lot of attributes, a lot of things to think about when it comes to new models now, where they're going to be.
Yeah, there's no doubt. We are definitely in strange new times right now, and I don't know when a normal as we know it is going to return, unfortunately. Denise, probably let Tony go. He's a busy guy. It's only 8:37 a.m. out on the West Coast.
He didn't even yawn once. I'm impressed.
Yeah. I know you feel like it. Do you have any last questions for Tony before we...
You know, my question, we didn't really dive into this, so I'll leave it pretty open-ended for you, Tony, is that, you know, you have been able to take, you know, you're probably one of the, if not the biggest name in the pizza business. And you've been able to kind of use that to kind of lift up the industry and cultivate this community of togetherness, especially during this time. You know, what do you hope happens with our industry as we move forward?
Yeah, you know, that's a good question. You know, when this all started, you know, we've always had a great camaraderie. I mean, I think when we found out Pizza Expo wasn't happening, that was hurtful. I mean, it people were upset. I was sad. I mean, like, there were a lot of emotions going on because that is a gathering point for us as operators around the world to go to. And it's, I've been doing it since I was, you know, I was 20 years old. I've been going, and I haven't missed one. And I went with my brother when I was really young. So when that was all happening and things were falling apart in a way, I kept on seeing videos online that didn't really help the operator. And this is at the early stages. I mean, now it's totally different, but it was like, hey, let's do a challenge. I'm at home. How many sit-ups can I do? Or how, you know, it was just stuff that was kind of fun and cutesy and cool, but there were things going that I was talking to insurance brokers that, what, I'm not going to be covered for this, or, you know, things that I was going back and we're getting together and doing deals and specials. And this was really kind of before at that time of, you know, when, hey, make the pizza at home, let's do a kit, you know, and when that all was happening, I felt like there wasn't a lot going on for the operators, and like, this is what's going on with me, and I'm not able to get my money. So I kind of started with, I've always been trying to be helpful with my, like, my fellow pizza makers out there and operators and owners.
Yeah.
For me, I teach, I'm not afraid to show my recipes. You're able to walk into my kitchen. My brother and I opened up a pizzeria, and we had no help. It's him and I. It's school hard knocks. You couldn't Google it. You had to figure it out. You couldn't figure out why your dough wasn't rising, why it wasn't browning well. How do I do New York style? What's this thing I heard, you know, called Neapolitan? I mean, there's just stuff that you just couldn't do. This wasn't on a computer, in your face, on YouTube. And when it came to that, there's people out there that maybe you would call, or you just meet them at expo. So for me, I always, it was an open book for me. I was just, you know, I'd be truthful. And if it didn't, I'd tell you if it didn't. And just that goes to starting the competitions and going into that and building the team. So when this all kind of happened, I just try to post a lot, not just of me, like, you know, kind of hanging out at home doing something. I just wanted to be as educational or, you know, when Grande came to me and said, hey, can we do a video on what you're doing? I said, yeah, we did pens. We did this. We did that. I've had Bogats, you know, Nick call me and say, can I use that? Or if I do this and it says, you know, the clean team on pizza and these guys who are sanitizing all day. We have a shift now that's just sanitizing. I mean, if you look at what we're doing now compared to what we were doing, and we always cleaned our restaurant, but we didn't have to have the clean team on a shirt. And people knew, like, when you're at a club, it's security or VIP and stuff. So there were things and ideas that I like to share with people, because I know what it was like when you didn't have access to all this. And I felt like at the time I had operators come to me and say, so what do I do? Like, well, you know, and it was really kind of odd. It brought me back to phone calls that, you know, Mikey Bausch should call me like at 12 o'clock at night when I didn't even know the guy. And he's like, oh, you have a Rotoflex. Could you help me? I'm like, who is this? Like, I'm 22 years old. I'm just starting out. And, you know, those kind of talks that you'd have with Scardino or guys like Carlucci, guys that would come to you and just ask you a question. I said, you know, it isn't edited. It's now. And when I did videos or I called them and I did a post, it was more about, this is what's going on at my house. I don't have all this editing to make it look beautiful. It's just, this is what I'm doing. And if I stutter a little bit, it is what it is. But I'm just trying to be helpful more for the operator. And you may not be able to, you know, you may have to pay them for sick leave. I mean, it may not. Nobody knows. I mean, you know, there are certain things that were coming up as questions that I had to, like, try to figure out. And I was lucky to have access to a lot of information. I have a good team. We did get together early. We became creative. And those kind of things that are sharing a lot. And I just think it helps everybody. And I don't care if they're stealing ideas or taking ideas. It's not about that. And I've done things that people have done before too. And I think we're all in it together. And this is a time that we shouldn't be selfish so much. You know, we should really be thinking about each other and how to get through this. And then really, like, you know, just do better and be better. I think we're going to come out of this better. Who knows what the future will be like, but when it comes to us, that when I've been pushed down, I've come back 10 times. I've done that a lot in my life. I use it. I did drink during this pandemic. I did get down. I did have days that I didn't know what was going on. And for me, that only happened a little bit. And then I just said, you know what, let's figure this out. Let's go full force and we'll come out of this better. And I think a lot of us will. I know all of us won't, but I think a lot of us will. And we're always in this together. And I get calls and emails and text messages every day from guys, from operators, from just, you know, either how are you doing or what do you think or what should I do? So, and I'm always there for them. So,
yeah, Tony, we really appreciate that. You know, that's why we exist. And you are a huge part of helping the industry propel itself forward even during these challenging times. So thank you for that. Thanks for all you do. We're gonna let you go so you can go get your day started out in California.
I'm running to work now.
The time to meet with everybody.
Thank you, Tony. Good luck with the new Capo. Okay,
thank you. Yeah, Laura Meyer's killing it. So she's there as the chef. I didn't have much to talk about her, but I really kind of came to her, and it was kind of funny real quick. I came to her and said, hey, what do you think? She said, well, let me think about it. You know, I said, you know, I'd love you to run Capo's. I this is a new menu. You can execute it. It's small plates. It's really some chef-driven items, and we're going to add a few things. And then she said, okay, you know, I'm really interested. And then she said, okay. And then I called her, or I called her. I said, hey, by the way, I'm going to have a ham and pineapple pizza on it. And she's like, are you? Yeah, and you may see a pizza with ranch. He's all, you're going to do that in San Francisco? I'm like, yeah, let's do it. You'll see. And then she's like, all right. But she's like, she even questioned me, like, you're going to do it in San Francisco? I said, yeah, we do it in other places. Don't worry. But she's killing it. And yeah, some of the stuff too that we did there too is the Jeremy Fish is the artist, and we came together to do a really, really cool. He's a world-renowned artist that's actually local. So we really did an awesome new look that went on shirts. And you think of how else can you make money at times like this? Prints, neckerchiefs, and a cool logo on a shirt does bring in some amazing income. And that's what we've been able to be fortunate enough, especially with Jeremy's help. So we're selling the heck out of shirts right now.
Yeah, that shirt is awesome, by the way. I saw it. It looked sweet.
Thank you very much. And yeah, so that's those are some ideas too that came out really, really well. But yeah, I'm lucky to have Laura with me on the team, and she's doing great.
She's fantastic. Denise, we need to get Laura onto a podcast soon.
Oh, actually. Yeah. She's on schedule. I think we got her on.
Laura's working right now. Sorry.
We can't steal her away yet.
7 days a week.
Tony's got her a little bit busy, but we'll,
you never get her. I'm just kidding.
We'll get her to carve 30 minutes worth of it.
All right. Well, take care.
All right. Thanks, Tony.
Thank you.
See you.